transferring a lot of energy from one state to another. It's the composite strain-based approach which I just described. You may be asking, how much can you actually transfer as far as energy? Optimistically, 60 to 80%. So this could be a very efficient system. If you look at this little cartoon down here, really what we're doing is we're just taking the piezoelectric, cooling it to a magnetostrictor so that we apply electric field, we can actually control those magnetic dipoles. So let's say you buy into that. The next question you should have for me, why do you want to do this at the nanoscale? Well, the next question you would like to ask me is, why would you like to do this at nanoscale? And look, I'm going to use Vijay here as my partner in crime to sort of explain why this is important. So Vijay understands magnetic materials, and if you have a magnetoelastic, which is a magnetostrictor control, the one comment you're going to make is it's a soft ferromagnetic material. And you say, well, what's soft? Go to your refrigerator. Now you put magnets on it, but the refrigerator isn't a permanent magnet. It's a soft ferromagnetic material. If you were able to go in with a microscope and look at it, what you would see is a domain structure there. And these domains would consist of north and south poles. And they would close upon themselves so they contain the magnetic circuit. So if you're an outside observer like Vijay is, you say, hey, that doesn't look like a magnetic material. I don't see any magnetic state. So now if you think about this, well, wait, I read the literature. I go back about 7 years ago, and physicists discovered that if you start cutting up this refrigerator into smaller and smaller pieces, you get to a critical dimension to get rid of the main ones. And lo and behold, you have a single domain structure. And what's really nice about this, if you're an outside observer, you actually see the presence of the field. And you may ask, how big is that field? It's on the order of 1 kilohertz. That's locally. So now we have a very strong magnetic field locally. Now the question is, can we control that with voltage or electric field? So the idea of CAMS is founded on is, look, we're going to take a ferromagnetic material. We're going to couple it with a ferroelectric material. And lo and behold, we're hopefully what we're going to do is you saw that going from north to south. To north to south, we're going to actually manipulate that magnetic structure with an applied voltage at length scales on the order of 100 nanometers. Now look, I'm going to show you some team data that says, look, we've actually been able to achieve this. And then I'm going to show you some data on single domain structure that says, guys, we've actually been able to achieve this. So it's time to actually start transitioning this technology into potential devices. Now, whenever people give presentations, I always like to hear, because maybe I'm not involved in their particular area, how does their research fit into the grand scheme of things? So this picture is supposed to be about the grand scheme of things. Let's go back in time to maybe 1880. The Curie brothers discovered piezoelectricity, coupling between electric fields and mechanical loading. Then, you know, what happened about 4 years later, Pierre Curie said, hey, you know what, since we discovered that, maybe there's this coupling between electric fields and magnetism. So he was one of the first people to have this idea about coupling phenomena. However, by the way, guys, he got it wrong, even though it was a great idea. Fast forward to 1960, the former Soviet Union, they discovered the first room temperature, single-phase multiphoric. However, by the way, it was crappy. You would never use it for anything. It was just sort of a novelty, a scientific curiosity. Fast forward to 1994, Schmidt actually coined this term multiphoric. You saw on that first slide of it, TAMS and TAMS name. Now, what happened in 2002 was people at Penn State actually took magnetostrictor control bolt, glued it to piezoelectric control bolt, and lo and behold, all of a sudden, a revolution started. 1,000 paper plus had been published in the last decade. Once again, you should be asking, well, how does our research in TAMS fit into the grand scheme of things? So look at this bottom box down here. Let's now focus, because I tried to make this argument to nanoscale is important. So first, let's look at thin-film multiphoric. We're talking about strain-mediated phenomena. Only about 50 plus papers out there. Let's go down and try to control single domain elements. Only about 10 plus papers out there. And then let's even go down smaller than that. Let's go down to the superparamagnetic level. There's really only one paper out there, and that's really by the group here at UCLA. So let's now dive into some work. So enough motivation. Now let's talk a little bit about research. So what you're going to see first, let's talk about the structures. The first thing is we're going to focus on a PMMPT as our ferroelectric thing. It's single crystal. You should be asking, well, why do you want PMMPT single crystal? Comment number one is all the structures we're talking about are nanoscale. So we need an extremely smooth surface. So I can get this with actually 1 nanometer roughness. The second thing is this PMMPT, I can actually get different cuts of it. So I can actually design in what strain state I get. That means I can have an isotropic strain, or I can have an anisotropic strain. If you want to deal with magnetic anisotropy, that's a very critical component. Now, on the top surface, we've used nickel film. Is nickel the best magnetoelastic material? No. However, it's a sufficient magnetoelastic material. It was one of the first magnetoelastic materials ever to be used in sonar transducers. So it's good. It's not the best. So you may ask, well, why did we choose it? It was easy for us to fabricate without having to go through the headaches of making very exotic materials. Once again, we want to get close to applications and actually just identify potential possibilities. So now that we have the structure, what we're going to do is put it together. We're going to apply an electric field, which is going to strain that thin film. The next three slides you're going to see are only based on thin films at different dimensionalities. Now look, if you look at the thin film, what you're going to recognize is that you have the main states in those thin films. Now what's really important, if you look at that top surface, you'll see those north and south poles. So if you're an outside observer, if you get the right type of film, you can actually see that. And what I'm going to try to show you is that we can apply an electric field and actually have those vanish. So once again, we're going to see some thin films, we'll see outside north and south poles, apply an electric field, and it's going to vanish. So let's go into some data now. We're going to start off, first film is going to be 35 nanometers thick. Now what's important about that thickness is all the magnetization states are now in plane. Did I discover that? No, that's well known in the community. So we chose a specific thickness of film. This is a plot of strain versus electric field for the ferroelectric that we're using, the PMMPT. This cut here is anisotropic strain. So what you see here is you'll see the X strain and the Y strain. So X is this direction, Y is this direction. So they're different in plane, and that's very important. Now the other thing I want to point out is what magnitude strain are we looking at? Now some of you may not hear strain that often, so let's just talk about percentages. We're talking about 0.1% strain. Is that a big number? I'm going to argue that's really, really small. So we're not talking about these large percent strains that sometimes you see in the community. If you go fly an aircraft, you ask, well, how much strain would that aircraft design to withstand? At least 0.5% strain. So if you put this on aircraft, it's below that strain threshold. So now let's look at some data. So over here you have magnetic response of our thin film. That's just one film. But we're going to look at the response along the X direction and along the Y direction. Now you may not look at magnetic curve that much, but you'll notice there's a difference between those two curves. And what you see is as you take the magnetic field off here, you actually have a really high remnant. Well, over here you have virtually no remnant. So what you're supposed to take from this is down here you have an easy axis, up here you have a hard axis. Now what we're going to do is walk through and fly voltage. So first time we fly voltage and it shifts the blue. Notice both of these curves shift. If you've heard the terms like that hard and easy, this curve now is something becoming more easy. This curve is something becoming more hard. We apply a little bit larger electric field, a little bit larger electric field, and about 1.2 megavolts per meter, all of a sudden this red curve up here looks about like this red curve down here. And now we've actually reordered that magnetization state so that it's in plane isotropic. It doesn't matter what direction I go in. Finally, we go up to about 1.6 megavolts per meter. Now we've actually reoriented the EZ axis from the Y direction to the X direction. So we've rotated it by 90 degrees, and these are two external measurements. Okay, so now you've got that, hopefully, on 35 nanometer itself. Now let's go to something slightly thicker, 60 nanometers. Let's don't look at magnetization curves. Let's look at MFM, magnetic force microscopy. And what we're going to do is we're going to take this tip and just scan along the surface. And what we argue is that you'll see local south and north poles coming out of this film. And as this magnetic tip goes over, it's going to create these stripe patterns. So you can imagine the black stripe is north, the white stripe is south. And the question is, can we control that? Now, by the way, this is entirely different phenomenon than you saw in the preceding slide. Before, there was no out-of-plane domain. Now they're out-of-plane. Now let's go and look at what we can do here. So we're going to look at an AFM image first, and down here is an MFM image. And this is at 0 megavolts per meter. Now let's apply a little bit higher electric field. We've applied 0.4 megavolts per meter. Notice down here, everything starts getting thinner, which means the strength of those north and south poles are suddenly starting to vanish. Over here, when we get to 0.8 megavolts per meter, now they virtually all vanished. So now we've theoretically taken a structure which has north and south poles pointing out of the plane and actually distributed all line in plane, sort of like we had on that preceding slide. Now you say, well, what happens if you take the electric field off? Well, you go back to the original state. Yes, there are some pinning states here due to the main formation in the ferroelectric. So this looks pretty cool now. If you can do that, let's go to thicker film, right? Why don't we just go to bulk? So now we go to 100 nanometers. Remember, the number went from 30 to 60 to 100. We still have the strike domain patterns here. Outside observer can still see them. But now when we apply electric field, look down here. Virtually no change. Does that mean nothing's going on inside the material? Nope, things are going on. But as an outside observer, it's a soft ferromagnetic material, so you've just reoriented everything. So from outside observer, it looks constant. So I'd like to say I've made the argument at this point, small is better for this type of technology. So if you buy that, let's now go in and start making things small. So that was continuous film. So what we're going to do now is we're going to look at some geometries between 100 nanometers and about 5 microns. How big is 5 microns? That's about the size of a red blood cell. So what we're going to do here is we're going to use basically CNSI facilities. And I have to point out here, one thing I love about being here on UCLA campus is we really do have excellent facilities. Because a lot of the work you're going to see cannot be done at other universities because they don't have the same facilities we have here. I think that's due to we have cross-cutting collaboration across not just departments, but also across schools. So today what we're going to look at is we're going to look at some shapes about 2 microns by 2 microns. Now, that's not real small. Then we're going to go down and we're going to look at a ring structure. This is about 300 nanometers if you can't see it. So we're getting smaller. And then we're going to go down to something about 100 nanometers in size. Now, I'm going to plant a seed. If you look at this, this may look like a motor to you. And over here, this should look like a memory to you. So now let's go through and let's see what we can do. So we're going to start off with a 2 micron by 2 micron dot. Now, that's not single domain yet. Now, for this work, we had to collaborate with some people over in Germany. And leave the world of electrostatics. And let's start putting charges in motion. Now is where we do current. So we're going to make a move in a specific way. So let me introduce a new quantity. We'll start a new unit called current and current density.
Right? What do we... Let's see, how do we want to do this? However, the divergence theorem says we have a closed flux integral of this variety. Remember, the divergence theorem is purely mathematical. It has nothing to do with the actual physical product here. We can just apply it with a algebraic relationship. We learned in this class that this is actually the same thing as integrating across the volume of the divergence of that vector. Remember that? It's just a mathematical relationship that you can commute the way up. And if this is zero for all regions of any possible volume you can think of, then the magnetostatic condition could be written even more elegantly. It's only zero. That's case number one. If it's case number two, then this is actually the change in volume charge density of x. We're not taking it to the point, so don't bother with that. The last thing that I'm saying is called the continuity theorem. Basically says that the charges cannot be created or destroyed. But that would be the idea of atomic charges. This is the kind of scenario that we're going to look at. We're going to do this because we're talking about electric fields, but we know that this is going to be magnetic fields. All the charges are in motion. You get a magnetic field. How does a magnetic field deliver your right-hand rule? We know that a field of curling right-hand rule is useful, right? We're doing a right-hand rule for cross products. You get the first vector, the second vector, the third vector. We're going to have it. We're just taking an example where this type of right-hand rule is a little bit more useful. If I have a current in space, one point in the direction of good, and the magnetic field swirls around that. If I have a charge that moves through that magnetic field, it will expand itself first, perpendicular to the field. If the field comes out like this, the charge isn't in this way, it will run towards the wire, the creative path. Okay, now, great point that I'd like to end up with. Yeah, sure, there's a lot on the board, it's useful to have. This is a little spot that's sort of up here, so I'm going to make a point. I think sometimes it's a bit lost in all the details of electromagnetism. If you've got a wire with currents in it, and the current is going this way, the magnetic field should come out of the board on top and go into the board at the bottom by the right-hand rule. Out of the board at the top, into the board at the bottom. Look at the arrow coming out the center of the screen. If I have a positive charge, and let's say this particular geometry that starts moving, well, let's say B field, the magnetic field, out of the board, the charge is going this way. So it's velocity times charge, cross into the field, and maybe the force vector on it. So this thing will actually move down towards the wire. But that's it, with more force, but gets exerted on it, and draws it closer to the wire. If I flip this, if I turn this into an electron, it will actually deflect, it will bend away.